We're happy to have Wendy Underhill, the Director of Elections and Redistricting from the National Conference of State Legislatures, to present us with a state legislative update. As I think many of us have been experiences, lots of changes happening based off of 2020. So we really appreciate you taking the time to meet with us today and to give us that overview.
I'm very happy to do that, and I am noticing behind you, Michelle, you have a keep it kind, you know, the donkey and elephant, and reminds me that the National Conference of State Legislatures and NASED both live on the shrinking island of bipartisanship, and we want to keep it as strong as we can, and I appreciate that you all are facing the same kinds of pressures that are found in the legislature. So, with that, I'll just move on to my next slide and say that some of you know NCSL, some of you don't. We do work on behalf of the legislatures in the nation. That includes the legislators and also the legislative staff. Both to come, I'd say it's 60% legislative staff that we hear from, 40% legislators. We serve 7,383 legislators, and I believe there is only one person who is a member of your organization and ours, and that's Paul from Oklahoma. So we have not only sort of some shared interests and the possibility of partnership and partnership on making elections better, but we also have our Venn diagram overlaps with Paul, which is kind of fun. So I'm going to talk about the laws that were enacted this year, and we're going to start by talking about the number of laws that there were introduced this year. And the number of introductions is 3,400, just over 3,400. And you can see that on the left. You can see that that's a whole lot more than in previous years. 2019 was the next highest year. So you could argue that from 2017 forward, there's been an upward trend. You'll notice, of course, that this is August. So we're not done with the year. There could be still more. And then when you go over onto the enactments side, you'll see that we don't exactly have a record-breaking number of enactments. It's down from 2019. We're at 264 right now, and I believe that that could easily go up from here because there are a number of states that are not yet done with their work for the year, some who use the entire year for legislative action as needed, and others that are in special session. So we'll see how that works out. So it could be that we had more noise and less signal, or at least way more noise and the same amount of signal as last year. Okay, on this slide, I just wanted to kind of line up where I'm going to go with this conversation. I'm going to break it into three parts. The first will be topics that really are new to the legislature this year based on what happened in the 2020 election. And then we'll look at the evergreen topics that are always of interest in legislatures. And then a little bit on cybersecurity and technology. I know you've had some on all of that already during your amazing conference. This agenda that you've set up is just amazing. And I sort of wish that we could encapsulate some parts of that and share that with the legislatures as well. I'm getting my mouse a little confused here. Poor thing, it's very confused by what I'm doing. Okay, there we go. Topics new this year. Well, we all know that the big topic last year was absentee and mail voting. And so it's not a surprise that a lot of the legislation that got enacted this year is based on last year's experience with ramping up from sometimes very small number of ballots that were sent by mail to a huge number in many different states. So the fact that there was that huge increase in absentee/mail voting means that the number of the topics that legislatures addressed this year relate to that. So here we've got ballot curing. I believe we had, let's see, I've got it here. Before this year, we had 18 states that had something to do with ballot curing processes, and now we have 5 more, as I understand it. And by the way, you all are the experts on what's true in your state, so if I get your state wrong, just go ahead and send me a note and we'll get it cleaned up. Sometimes we read a bill and we think it's new and it's actually just a tweak on something that already existed. So whether that's a today or any other day, if you see things on our website that aren't right, we're just humans, so let us know and we will get it corrected for you and we'll count it as a favor. At any rate, on ballot Turing, the thing I've heard about from two people just in the last month is, can't we use text? And of course, in Colorado, you can use text and probably some other places to cure a ballot. I don't know whether that's going to continue with other places as well or not, an interest in that, but I wouldn't be too surprised to hear more about that. And then there's ballot collection and ballot drop boxes, and I'm going to take the drop boxes first. Before the 2020 election, there were just 8 states that had the word drop box or the concept of drop box in their statutes at all. And then this year, you can see all those many states have addressed it in one way or another. In the past, most drop box statutes related to the security measures around it. That's still true, but also some other things. For instance, in Florida, they now require that they be distributed around the jurisdiction in a way that makes for equal opportunity for voters. In Hawaii, they said that the location of them needs to be announced and promulgated and encouraged so that the community knows where to look for them. Illinois said that it would be okay to use HAVA funds for it. And in Maryland, it establishes a whole bunch of things. It was quite a comprehensive look, and some of that was about security. And let's see, in Minnesota, they focused primarily on security. And so you get the idea that they can go in different ways, but that's been a topic of significant interest. Perhaps it's easier to legislate on something specific like drop boxes than some of the bigger things. I don't know. And then you've got ballot collection. And of course, this also created some furor last year, who could bring a ballot back that had been voted by voter at home and return it to a drop box or to an election office. And there are, in most states, some kind of a limit on who can do that. Mostly it's a family member or a household member or a caregiver, and other than that, it's the voter. A couple of exceptions to that where a person can collect more than that. In Iowa this year, they switched from calling it the voter designee to a household member or family member, so that's more semantic than otherwise. And in Montana, they did actually put a $100 per ballot fee or fine, I should say, on anyone who did collect ballots. So if you were getting paid for it, that's what was illegal. You couldn't get paid to do that. And that, we could just go on and on and on with all the details related to absentee voting. I'll just put a few things here, and you all have other ideas, and I hope that I've got enough time saved that we can have a nice conversation about some of this at the end. So Arizona and Arkansas made it clear that they do not want election officials distributing absentee ballot applications, that that's not accounted for in law, but now it is in the negative. Indiana, Maine, Louisiana, and North Dakota did permit now, moving forward, the preparation of ballots for counting before election day. You all remember lots of conversation last year about it, if you can't open the ballots until election day, you might have a lengthy period before you can get the results out. So this is addressing that. And then in Kentucky, they created an online portal to request a ballot. Now, I don't think that's super unusual, and many of your states may be doing that through administrative rulemaking capacity of your own. I'm not quite sure, but Kentucky did it with a new statute. Now, the first thing I want to do on this slide is apologize. You'll note at the top, I said enactments relating to election officials, and then on the key, you see the word poll watchers. I promise I will never use this slide again. After I realized that was a problem, I just couldn't quite get it fixed in time. I put them together because they're people who are working in the poll place in some way, but I didn't really write in about poll workers. So I've mixed up the people who actually run elections with poll watchers, and I do apologize for that. But let's take that first. That, again, was a bit of a question, and I did get queries in the beginning of this year about how close a bill could allow poll watchers to be to election workers. And I said that really the question is, how far back must they be to not impede the poll workers? So that was the thing, but really the efforts that have been done by the states have not been all that significant. Okay, we're going to skip right past Kansas, Montana. I know in Kansas you have to wear your badge, and in Montana, you one of these states you can watch not just the polling. Oh, and yes, in Montana you can watch at the drop box, so you can send poll watchers to stand in a bipartisan team by the drop boxes and watch that as well. But now let's move on to the things that do relate to you all more precisely. And with that, let's start in Arkansas. It has a requirement that counties send irregularities to the state election board, and Georgia has something like that as well, where the state election board will have more control over the locals than in the past. And in Kansas, there's a requirement, or they made a felony out of impersonating an election official, and likewise in Arizona. Now, I actually don't remember the stories from last year of people impersonating election officials that would have prompted this, and maybe we can come to that during the question and answer, and one of you can fill me in on that, but it's now there's a law that you can't do that, which makes a fair amount of sense. In Arizona, they also say that no one can modify election-related dates. So if it's set in statute, they don't want officials to be changing those dates for any part from the very beginning of the process to the end. And I believe Kansas also did something like that, said if we put it in statute, a timing issue, that's what it's going to be. Now, let's see, Iowa created penalties for election officials if they are found to have willfully failed to perform their duties. And then in Wisconsin, there are more requirements for the state election commission to distribute the minutes and many, many other things related to all of their meetings, to post them all publicly. And I'm surprised at this because I know Wisconsin is a very transparent state, and this bill was very specific about what it wanted. And usually that kind of specificity is not found in statute. In Texas, there are two bills I wanted to mention. One is that the Secretary of State can withhold funding from any voter registrars around the counties who doesn't do their work in a timely manner. So this is a stick, not a carrot, to get the local election officials to keep the voter rolls up to date. At least that's how I'm reading that. And they also have a law that says that no one, it's a felony, if to intentionally try to count a vote that you know is invalid, or the flip, to not count a vote that you know is valid. So I think that's probably already against the law, but now it's much more explicit there. So when you put all of that, wrap that all up together, there were a bunch of bills in many places and the enactments that you see here on the screen that relate to how election officials do their job. And you might say between what's the role of the local election official and what's the role of the state official. And I don't know, having clarity on who's responsible for what is a pretty good thing most people can get on board with. But I will say that the New York Times put out an article maybe 2 months ago called How Republican States Are Expanding Their Power Over Elections. So if anyone wants to look into more about the variety of bills that are on this topic around the nation, that's a place that you could look. And then we all know that last year there was funding provided to local election officials if they chose to accept it to run elections in the face of a COVID pandemic. And this year, a number of states, that's 9 states have prohibited the accepting of outside funding. I think you all know about that. I had sort of expected, or maybe as a Pollyanna had expected, that this kind of interest would make states think to themselves, what does it take to run an election and why is this even an option out there? And therefore, we consider more funding. But I didn't see bills that are producing more funding through state sources. So sorry to bring that to the table. And then the last one in this first section is that a lot of the bills were really long. Some states do have a single subject rule and they only have one thing in a rule. For instance, Arkansas passed 25 bills that related to elections this year. Each one was a very specific thing. And I'm guessing that they have that single subject rule there. But a lot of them were really big, and that includes the Georgia one and the Iowa one. And there was a great big one in Pennsylvania as well that got through the legislature and was vetoed by the governor. All right, Amy, I'm just going to keep on going, and we'll take questions at the end. If you want me to do it, other, I see you saying yes. Okay, so Evergreen, you know these topics. These are things that have been on the radar for at least a decade, and in reality for 2 decades. So on the early voting, you probably have heard that Kentucky added 3 days of early voting. and Iowa and Louisiana both reduced their early voting period to some extent. Iowa, I think, went from 29 to 19 days, and Louisiana 18 to 7, if I've got that right. And Michelle, check me on this if you will, but I think Massachusetts adopted no excuse absentee voting. That's how I would call it for forever on. And I think you're calling it mail-in voting, perhaps.
Right now, ours is actually limited to, it expires December 15th, 2021.
Right. Okay. I guess I did get that, but it was only 2021. Thank you. Thank you. And then on all mail elections, oh, I'm sorry. I didn't actually mean to go that way quite yet. Take my fingers off. Two new states have gone to all mail voting, and that there were 5 before, as you probably know, and now there's 2 more. So you could say, oh my goodness, that's a 40% increase in the number of states that have all mail voting. It's a huge trend. Or you could say, yeah, well, 5 + 2 = 7. It's still very, very, very much in the minority. Voter ID, you know, that is absolutely a perennial topic. What was new this year is that Wyoming adopted it for the very first time ever, and Arkansas changed its rules to be a little bit stricter. Indiana also permitted an ID produced by a Native American tribe to be used as a acceptable ID. And then you can see Missouri, Nebraska, and Pennsylvania may be sending to the ballot in 2022 constitutional amendments that will open the door for them to have either the first time ever or a stricter form of voter ID. And if the Missouri, Nebraska, and Pennsylvania people are here, we can see what you think about that. At this point, it's kind of a guess on my part. And then registration. And it used to be, let's say 2015, 16, that registration was the whole deal. That was all anybody wanted to talk about. But now there's all this other stuff going on, so I just gave it that one little spot over there. And I'm hoping that the people in Delaware and Hawaii were able to hear Rob Rock talk about automatic voter registration earlier today, or that they could come to you after the fact to get some thoughts on how to do it. Maine has joined the group of states with online voter registration. Montana repealed its election day registration. And then my notes say that Alabama, Nebraska, and Oklahoma all have done what they need to do to be able to join ERIC, although I don't think that they've yet joined it. And now, Jen, my mouse is in the wrong place. Come on back.
Wendy, while you find your mouse, Alabama's been a member of ERIC for a couple of years.
Okay, thank you. I wonder what I got that made me think that. And I wonder where my little mouse has gone to. I'm in a new studio like place with data. Here we go. That should do it. Okay, so NGSL just built the space for us, and we don't really have all the wrinkles worked out. Okay, so all those things that were on the last slide, I thought I'd put them in perspective. If you take the year 2000 and take it to year 2020, you can see that every one of the things that were on the slide before, there's more of now by a fair amount than then. And then the yellow column adds in what I thought was true for this year, and I think we're pretty good on that. And I guess my reason for wanting to share this slide is that it shows the things that all of these things are trends. All of them are moving forward. They don't all necessarily sort of tend toward the D side or the R side, but they are all slowly making their way forward. I see you. There we go. All right, Jen, I don't know what it is that makes something enough of a trend that it gets a slide of its own, but I did make one for ranked choice voting, and I did that because there were 4 enactments. They were all pretty small, but still 4 is enough to count as a trend, I'd say. The big news, as you know, Maine has been doing ranked choice voting for state elections for a while, and Alaska adopted it by a vote of the people in 2020, so it will be debuting that soon. And Alaska's plan is pretty unusual. It combines a all-comers primary, a nonpartisan primary, and the top 4 of those folks go over to the general election where they'll use the ranked choice voting. Mostly, though, this is about local elections, and in Georgia, it's for their primaries, where Georgia has a primary runoff, and this is the way to only have to send 1 ballot to the overseas voters. They can vote it with instant runoff, I believe that's the phrase being used in Georgia, and then they can participate both in the first primary and then also in the runoff. I do hear from proponents of ranked choice voting that this could be done anywhere with any technology. I want you to know that I don't say that myself. I say when we're asked about it that you need to check in with your state's election officials, because technology can be a little bit of a barrier on this. Let's find out more about what it would take in your state to make that move. Then I noticed early in the year that we were getting several questions about voting for people with disabilities. And so I went back to see if it really was a trend. And I don't know, when I put it on a time scale, we've got 5 this year and 5 in 2019 and 3 in 2017 and 2015. So the trend I see is that it's more about odd numbered years. And I cannot think of a reason why voting for people with disabilities comes up in the odd numbered years. If anybody else has an idea, let me know. And here are the 5 that I highlight for this year. Colorado's is the biggest, in my opinion, on the changes that it's making. It's allowing emergency absentee ballots. That doesn't mean somebody who wants a ballot early in advance, but someone who's getting down to, I believe, within a week of election day, doesn't have the ballot, needs help, to be able to request it and receive it and also return it electronically. And Nevada's new law is, I believe, similar to that. I feel a little uncertain on both of these. And Jed, if you want to pop in here and tell me if I've got that straight on Colorado, you all know while we're talking about anything related to sending and receiving electronically, there are going to be security activists who will have an opinion about that. And then in Montana, they've simply said that all the small elections, such as school board elections and municipal elections, need to be equally accessible as the general elections, and also that a voter's agent can't be their employer or a union representative, that kind of a thing. So person who needs assistance can designate their own, but it can't be that kind of a person. And then in Virginia, we're going to skip the one about candidates and just go to the one about requiring that a voter with disability can ask for and then receive back and mark electronically their ballot, that they would need to print it out and mail it back in. That should do it. All right, and now we're on to the next chunk. And here, I know that this is something that you all have spent 4 years, if not all of your careers, focusing on making sure that your elections are well run and that the technology is working for all the people in a smooth way that is accountable to the highest of standards. I totally get that. And I know that the 2020 election, you guys rocked it. The elections were secure and very strong. I did think that there would be interest in this topic, and there has been some interest, but not as much as I had expected this year. And maybe that's a testament to how well it did go last year in regard to cybersecurity. So in Arizona, there's now a requirement that there be security for all physical or electronic access to voting machines or electronic poll books. My guess is that that's always been true, and that this is sort of doubling down on it and maybe putting a little parameters around the side of it. And in Arkansas, the counties must certify to the Secretary of State that there is no internet connection between the poll books or voter registration or any part of the process with the internet. And in my mind, that's both highlighting that question and also identifying who is responsible for it. And I'm guessing that you all might not always like to have the legislature write bills that maybe they're too specific and become outdated too quickly. If that's the case, you might like the Montana version. It requires the adoption of rules that define and govern election security and some other things, but it gives that responsibility to the executive branch to do that. And then in Washington, this is another bill that I think could easily find its way around to other states, and that is that election operation plans and all the security risk assessments and that kind of security stuff is not accessible through a FOIA request. And that's, of course, because we want to not have the bad guys go in and find out what the plan is for protecting against the bad guys. So I don't know if that's something you want to bring up with folks in your state. Washington has done it. Oh, okay, and I see Jed has said, well, I missed it. We'll catch that on the back end. Okay, risk limiting audits. I really wanted to talk about post-election audits, but I asked Jennifer Morrell for a slide that would identify who's got what, and she gave me the risk limiting audits one. So I know that there's about 2/3 of the state do have some kind of a post-election audit, and those are well codified, understood, and working just fine. But here you can see states that are somewhere along the path with risk limiting audits. And this year, I would like to report on top of those. We have 3 other states that have done something. And Alabama, Mish got that on there. I believe they're requiring a post-election audit. I'm not sure that it's a right choice, risk-limiting audit. And Texas will hold a pilot risk-limiting audit before the 2026 election. And Nevada will do so before the 2022 election. So pilots does seem to be the way that risk-limiting audits and a few other things, ranked choice voting as well, seem to spread around the country. And I'm almost done. Those are kind of the things I thought I would highlight. But there are lots of other things that we could talk about. And you had a great discussion about voter list maintenance. I will say that a lot of the bills I see are still saying check death records, check NCOA records, check felon records. And I think some states have that long since in their laws. But if you don't, now's a good time to do that kind of checking. And we did talk about Eric before, another list maintenance option. And I heard someone say earlier that we that kind of have to change the tone around list maintenance from either a chore or purging to this is a good thing that makes our elections run well. So that's what I'm thinking. Felon voting is always something that's on the minds of legislators. And the trend over 20 years has absolutely been from more restrictive to less restrictive. And I've pulled 2 that are making it, making people be able to return to voting sooner in the process. Primaries, usually after an election, you'd think there'd be a lot of bills on it, but not so much. Presidential electors, there were several bills early this year that proposed to go to the congressional district approach to distributing presidential electors. So instead of it being all of the electors from one state going to the winner of the statewide popular vote, that there first be one identified for each congressional district and then 2 would go to the statewide winner. Well, a lot of noise, not much action. And then my last law I just wanted to bring to your attention comes out of Alabama, and its intention is to prevent double voting, meaning voting in 2 different elections. You wouldn't think you'd need that law, but 12 states expressly prohibit this, but 7 states say you can't vote twice within the same state or for the same office, but that leaves a little squishy territory about can you vote in your snowbird state as well as your home state. So we do have a webpage on this called Double Voting. It gets very little attention, but this might be another sort of not too heavy a lift to if you're interested in that at all to bring to your legislators. Okay, so I do hope that we've got time for a conversation. I do want you to know that we have a newsletter that I hope you'll find useful. Last month it was about audits. And this month, I don't know, I can't remember what we're doing this month. And we're happy to send that to you, just let me know. And also, I'm thinking that if we are partners or if we can think of ourselves as 2 organizations, both trying to promote better elections, then one way we could partner, if you're interested, is that your state association could invite one of us from NCSL to perhaps ask legislators from your state if they'd like to come and have a conversation with you all. I've done this a few times, not so much in the last 2 or 3 years, but prior to that, where we have a panel of either 2 or 4 people, have to be balanced with Democrats and Republicans, so that's why 2 or 4. And they can each give their perspective on what they're looking for, and then the audience, the election officials, can share what's on their minds. So if that idea appeals to you at all, I'm open to that kind of collaboration, and I'm also especially open to any other ideas that might come up here on how we could collaborate together. All right, I'm going to stop sharing and see what we got.
Wendy, so let's see. In the chat, Jed says, as for Colorado, Wendy's correct. Under the new law, emergency and disabilities can receive a ballot electronically and for the most part return them electronically. And Mark Walashin in Nevada notes that the recent law, they have a recent law that extended their RLA pilots through 2022 with full implementation in 2024.
Great, thank you. That's the kind of thing I need to hear from the real people who know the details.
And Kentucky looks like, Jared says, Kentucky was able to add an RLA pilot in the last legislative session.
Well, great.
As well.
Right, great.
And let's see, Linda Lamone, you have a question if you'd like to unmute yourself and ask.
Hi, Wendy, Linda. Did you, you were going to redistribute your last newsletter discussion of audits with some amendments to it. Have you done that?
Yes and no. I have edited it. That's the wonder of doing something online, and we've removed the offending parts, and I can go into that if people want, but now if you click into the same place, you're going to get the new and improved version. Basically, this was, we do here in our universe, and we've heard from outside folks, you know, this phrase of forensic audits, and we didn't identify what that was, but we had mentioned it as a thing. We've now moved it into a paragraph that says some people are talking about a forensic audit, but there's really no definition of that. Here's what does exist in statute and things that legislators can consider doing. I totally understand it, and I was appreciative that I got that heads up that we needed to change that to not encourage the use of that phrase let's just leave it at that, to not use that phrase because it doesn't have a definition to go with it.
Yeah. Thank you for doing that, because we're getting an awful lot, I think, around the country, the use of the phrase, and the people that are using it don't know what it means. So,
you know, at some point when people are using a phrase, the phrase begins to be something, and you know, we can shout a lot about there is no such thing, but if enough people are using that phrase, we've got to figure out a different way to be responsive to that. I mean, I think the answer might be to say, hey, we've got some great audits already in place. Come, let me show you what we got.
Yeah, I agree, but thanks for doing that.
Yeah, you got it.
So we're also seeing in the chat, some discussion of the other kinds of audits that are required in states. So Iowa requires a post-election audit of each county after every election, and Illinois requires a retabulation of ballots in 5% of each election authority's precincts. And in addition, 5% of the devices used in early voting are also selected for retabulation for each election jurisdiction.
I'm pretty sure we've got those noted on our post-election audit page, and that's something that we could check. I think we've got those percentages and things, but Amy, at the end, if I could have these notes from the chat, that would be helpful, and I can go back and make sure I've got things tidied up.
Yep. One question I have for you, you mentioned that there was some legislation about impersonating election officials, and I was curious what that does that mean, impersonating election officials in person or impersonating election officials in written communication? Because I think we've all seen some kind of confusing communications that sometimes come out from well-meaning groups. And so I'm curious what your understanding is of those bills.
I actually can't answer that. When I saw those, I said, wow, these are two that look very similar. There's something behind this story, but I haven't dug down into it, but I certainly can. And I assumed in-person impersonation, and it made me think of perhaps what happened in Mesa County with people who aren't election officials having access to things. But it's not in response to that, because that's this year, and these bills are presumably responding to things from 2020. Are other people out there aware of what would be the impersonation question that makes states have that new requirement?
Hey, this is Brian from Kansas. We're one of the states involved, so I can talk what I'm going to have to guess some, because our office was not consulted before the legislature passed the law. And in addition, it's being litigated in both state and federal court. There are two separate lawsuits concerning this exact clause, one state, one federal. So stay tuned. But what I believe, my personal opinion on what they were getting at, are third parties that were distributing advanced voting ballot applications and making it seem like it was coming from the state or the county, when in effect it was coming from a third party. I believe that's where most of the noise was. However, there's lots of consternation from organizations like the League of Women Voters and the ACLU and colleges who think that they are now tied up into this and they can no longer do voter registration drives. So quite frankly, I'll be in court quite a bit over this issue in the next couple months, but that's what I've got right now.
Wow. And that would get to what you were saying, Amy, about this could easily be about written word, not in person trying to sneak in behind the gates.
I have another question, but I would like to open it up to NASED members to ask Wendy questions as well.
And I'm hoping that people will have these ideas about how we can make the connection between election officials and legislators tighter. I know that you often could make a bill a stronger bill if you had the advanced opportunity to do that. And I'm not in a position where I can say to them, hey, you got to call up so-and-so, but whatever we can invent together, I can take forward with the, within the parameters, the guardrails of our job as a non-advisory group.
Wendy, one question I have, and it's actually something that I've spoken about with at least one state, the Georgia provision about using ranked choice voting for their UOCAVA voters. Is that common across states? Are there several states that do that? It seems, I mean, my personal opinion is it seems kind of confusing, but I'm curious how common that is and if you've seen it either coming up elsewhere or in existence elsewhere.
It is in existence elsewhere. I see Karen says it's in South Carolina. So there are several states in the South that tend to have primary runoffs. So first you have to reduce the universe to the states that have primary runoffs. And then if there's only 3 weeks between the primary and the runoff, you can see that there's kind of a problem. And I do believe that somewhere in the past there were challenges to the right to vote for the overseas people, and so that this was a solution for that. And it's not that brand new. It's new for Georgia, but it's not a new concept. We do have a web page called Primary Runoffs, and we'll tell you which states have it. We may not have Georgia on it at this moment, but we do have the ones that have traditionally had that. And it's almost like it predates almost the move to ranked choice voting in municipalities and such.
Thank you. Other questions? I have more. I'm curious, Wendy, given the sort of volume of legislation and also obviously everything that happened last year, how frequently you're getting questions from legislators about elections and how often they're coming to you and asking for, you know, resources or things like that.
You know, it varies a huge amount. We have closer relationships in some states than in others. It's just the nature of the beast. We provided lots of information to Pennsylvania and to Georgia and to Wisconsin information of our own, plus suggestions in Pennsylvania, at least on people who could testify as they were considering the bills in their place. So sometimes it's pretty close. Sometimes we just get a question on the margin from someone. So it's a mixed bag, and it's my job to try to have a relationship with the chairs of the election committees. And sometimes it's easier than other times. And once you're in the door, then it gets much easier, which I would then say that if we were to do this thing where we could go to a state and bring the chairs in to have a conversation with election officials, that helps you, but it also helps me because then they know us. So, and then in terms of the number of questions, it's been about on track with previous years. I wouldn't say it's more, so there's more legislation, but not more questions. And our team answers about 500 questions a year from legislators and legislative staff. And right at the moment, I will say that redistricting is consuming a huge amount of our team's work. But I want you to know that every time I talk about redistricting, I always talk about the handoff of that data to the election officials and what goes on afterwards. So I'm trying to make sure that legislators and others who do redistricting know that that's only part of the process before you can actually get to running the next year's elections.
And I'll put in a plug for all of the resources that NCSL has on their website. As someone with a sort of national perspective, I send links to your website out a ton, both to NASED members, but also to members of the public and to the press, because it's very, very helpful. So thank you for the work that you do. Do we have other questions or comments from anyone?
Hey, Amy, it's Jonathan. I have a question. Wendy, thank you for the presentation. I'm curious, did you notice any new trends in terms of categories of legislation that were more likely to be passed by divided chambers, partisan divided chambers?
You know, I want to say yes, because we know that we're living in a more partisan world than ever. But I got to tell you, when we're talking voter ID 10 years ago, it was mighty partisan and came right down to it. So the party in control absolutely does set the agenda and absolutely does determine what bills are enacted. And sometimes things like in Kentucky, they can figure out how to work together, and we love to point to those. But I would say on average, or I'd say that almost all the bills have a very strong lean one way or the other. Ranked choice voting, they tell us, doesn't have to be a Democratic bill, and there are certainly some Republicans who are interested in it too. Sometimes it's the minority party, as opposed to the D's or the R's, it's majority versus minority. But most of the time, you can kind of tell who's going to have sponsored it and who's going to have voted for it. So politics is very much in play with virtually everything we talked about today.
Hey, this is Jed. I had a good question. So given the, frankly, somewhat crazy conspiracy theories we're getting about voter registration bloat, so the sort of list maintenance problems of dead voters or unknown people being added to the lists, and it seems like that would make automatic voter registration more attractive, because in that scenario, the majority of your registrants are happening at a DMV where they're standing in front of a public official and they're showing two forms of ID. So is there any movement at all on the right-hand side to advocate for automatic voter registration in an effort to curb what they perceive to be potentially fraudulent activity?
I guess, Jed, I would respond by saying that Eric definitely has supporters from both sides, and I think it's that very piece that makes Republicans in Wisconsin say, let's get on board, we can do better. So, yeah, I think that's one of the places where you can find bipartisan support, and maybe it's not based on, you know, you want it because of this thing and they want it because of that thing, but you come to the same place and can adopt it. And I do think that the messaging on that, and we heard some of it on the earlier panel about voter list maintenance, is about good government and about clean rolls. And you, if you don't want people who don't belong in the rolls, let's do that. And one way to do that would be to have a portal or a plan, an automatic system, automated, perhaps electronic. The words matter sometimes. And I've also wondered the same thing about the online portals for asking for absentee ballots, that maybe those are also a way to separate out the real people who can be identified electronically to be real voters from any other paper applications that might be floating around. I don't know that to be the fact, but it does seem as though not only it streamlines it in terms of efficiency and how long it takes to process, but maybe it is a more secure way to request an absentee ballot.
Time for one more question.
I got something, Amy, if it's all right.
Yep, go ahead, Mark.
Perfect. Hi, it's Mark out in Nevada. Quick question in regards to kind of future assessments as well. I don't know if you have it, or maybe it's probably maybe worth updating, but I want to present at least an idea of maybe looking at like our organizational structures across the country. You know, in addition to recognizing that, again, as really time goes on and people become more transient and kind of move between states, you know, we all kind of continue to get folks that are asking questions about, hey, I thought we did this or that, and usually it's pretty quick that we can trace it, and they're like, I think I know what state you moved here from, but it's different here, that sort of thing. There might be some merit in maybe providing information, again, certainly not names, right? We're trying to keep everybody safe and protected, but that might be something worthwhile to assess the differences in state election division organizational structures, how many people each state has, you know, and kind of really why we're all jealous of Colorado, that sort of thing, you know what I mean? You know, kind of given what they have, just in general, right? Because again, I think one, it's certainly going to change. There have been a number of discussions I've had with some of my counterparts where we're all kind of looking at the requirements and trying to figure out, you know, what we would like to transition to, what may be possible based on what our legislatures and budgets will frankly allow in the coming years. But that might also be something that, you know, maybe not right now, but I could see maybe post 2024, if we're able to say, hey, look, another good news story, you know, election officials across the country recognized that there were increasing requirements and legislatures provided the funding to get more FTEs. And look, now they're better manned to be able to meet the requirements of the electorate. There may be some potential for that sort of assessment going forward. We'll see. Just a thought.
Well, Mark, I want to say I'm probably going to call you up to have a conversation about this other than that. But I also want to say I'm jumping on your plan, your dream. I want to be part of your dream. In 2024, we can say we had more staff, we had more money. I say we. You can tell that I was really meant to be an election official, not just an election observer. Get more staff, more money, and well-run elections because we connected the dots between now and then.
It wasn't a question. I apologize, though. I could form it in the same shape of question. Yeah, thank you. I appreciate your input and discussion, though, for sure.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Wendy. I will turn it back to Michelle to close us out for today.